Today we're going to talk about the BigTreeTech version 1.4. The reason that I'm redoing this tutorial yet again is that there's been some changes that have occurred in the Marlin firmware. So some of the processes have changed, and I thought I'd add some of the things I've learned along the way. So to start with, I'm going to talk about steppers. We have our X stepper, our Y stepper, our Z stepper, our E0 stepper, and our E1 stepper. Now inside of here, there's several ports that you can use for your NEMA 17 steppers or motors to actually drive them. And with this, you also have the ability to connect the A and B stepper ports when you're using the Z axis. They also have these 2-pin connections over here. And what those are 12 volt or 24 volt power out. So what I'll do is I'll explain what is going on for different power sources so you understand. So over here, I've marked the in power and the ground power. So you have voltage and ground. So red is voltage. I do the same marking for the out power for the bed power. And then we have our HE1 or our first extruder being HE0, pardon me. And then HE2 being HE1, which is your second extruder, pardon me. So over here we have 2 fan ports. Now, the thing you need to understand about these fan ports is that one of them has an addressable signal pin so that you can drive certain things automatically, such as automated cooling of your steppers or other things that you may be working with, such as your extruders. Now, with the stepper ports, there's also closed loop pins that they've included on this board. I may talk about that in the future, but with these steppers, you can use several different types that you'll see in my playlist, and I'll include a link in the description for you, but I'll give you a quick rundown of what they are. For step dir or step direction drivers, you can use the A4988 or DRV8825, and there are other ones as well. It also will do SPI, which is serial peripheral interface, and it will do UART communication as well. So you have a full range of steppers that you can use for the TMC type steppers, and they have the breakout pins already integrated into the board logic on the tracings. So, with those two things covered, I'm going to talk about first our display. So they have a legacy display set of ports here for the EXP1 and 2. And so it's EXP1 and 2 right here. You can also use a TFT display. And the TFT display has a port that's located, I believe, right over in here. But I have to check my pinout diagram. It's right there, actually. It also has what's known as the Wi-Fi connectivity. You have your SD card reader right here. And then you also have your USB connection or universal serial bus connection right here. It also includes two fuses that are car fuses that are easy to replace. And then there's a jumper for board power or PSU power. So board power would be something like 5 volts of power from your USB cable. Inside of here, they've also integrated in certain connections that you can use for the BL touch for your end stop if you so choose. And there's also a I2C set of pins down in here. Now, over in here, we have our actual end stops. And as they're outlined right here, we have our X minimum, our Y minimum, and our Z minimum. The other two up here for X max and Y max are now used for filament detection runout. We also have just below that the power detect set of pins. So they're using a signal pin to emulate an environment so that you can detect when something is either true or false with an end stop. So we also have a reset pin over here. And then we have in here our bed thermistors. So the bed thermistors are used to tell temperature so that it can address the current that goes to your actual either heat bed or your thermistors. So now that we know that, I need to talk about our actual SD card. Now there's two ways to actually load firmware on here that are easy. There's a third way, but I don't want to talk about that one. And with it, you can do it through your serial cable by connecting here and then connecting to your board. And you'll be able to do that through the upload feature of VS Code if you've set it up correctly, which I'll show you in a moment. But for now, what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to pop this out and place it in an SD card reader and place it in the computer. This is the second way to do this, where you can take this out after you've loaded firmware on it and place it in the drive. So I'm going to hook this up to the computer. You may hear a beep. And what we'll do is we'll go over and we'll see what the pinout diagram looks like. So for the BigTreeTech SKR version 1.4, you can see the pins are all outlined around the board. So the SWD would be one way to load software that I didn't talk about the pins, but they're located in here someplace, right here actually. And then of course you have spy pins that I missed earlier, and they're located here, as well as the I2C, which I did cover. And then there's a NeoPixel set of pins as well. But whenever you see 1.29 or something to that effect, that means it's a signal pin. So now that we know that, we can go and download the current version of Marlin. And there's been some changes in Marlin, so I'm going to click on this and download it and then show you how to deal with it. So once that's done downloading, we're going to have to go over to our downloads folder, which I'll bring up right now, right click, and then do extract all, and then click the extract button. That's going to take a few moments to actually download. So I'm going to show you some stuff real quick on the Marlin website. So over here in help, they have a bunch of different things to explain how to set things up and how to deal with your board, as well as G-codes to explain stuff. And then they also have the ability to go over to their website for GitHub, and you can actually open up bugs over here as well. So what you can do is, it's been a while since I've actually been here, so we're gonna see what the issues are. So over here, you can actually search on open issues just by hitting enter, and it'll show you all the things are currently open. Now they have a process that they'd like you to follow when opening a bug, and it's in the actual new issue. So they explain all the processes that are involved. You can also do feature requests as well in here. So now that we've got this actually downloaded and extracted, I'm going to go over to VS Code, and I'm going to click on the Explorer over here, then Open. Then I'm going to go to my Downloads folder, my Marlin folder, and then my Marlin folder again, and then Select Folder. Inside here, what we're going to do is we're actually going to set up our environment. Now, as you can see, the default environment is for a Mega 2560, which is a RAMS type configuration. It's the original Marlin configuration before they added other boards. So that's why the chipset says Mega 2560. So first thing we want to do is actually go over to the Marlin folder, the source folder, the core folder, and then boards.h. Inside here, we're going to search on SKR underscore V1.4, I believe. And I might be doing this wrong because it's actually an underscore. But as you can see, it says that there's a SKR up here. And currently, that says the chipset version is LPC 1768. Now, I'm working with a turbo board. So on the underside, there's a little sticker that says turbo. So it's going to be slightly different. It's going to be the one down below that has turbo. So I'm going to highlight that and copy it. Next thing I'm going to do is minimize core and source. Now I'm going to also note over here what the actual chipset is, which in this case is the category LPC1769. And that'll come into play in a few moments. So I'm going to click on configuration.h and I'm going to search on motherboard. Over here is where the RAM's default is. We're going to paste what we just copied. Then I'm going to scroll up and change the first serial port to -1. And in past configurations, there was a second serial port that we could set. And that's used for your TFT display. It's currently commented out, but if you want to use it, you can hit the control slash and it'll take out the comment. But in this case, we're not going to use it, so I'm going to do control slash to hide it again. But you can also modify the actual speed now. Now, they've done the same thing, but they've added a third COM port that you could possibly use for something like Wi-Fi. So now that we know that, what we need to do is actually set this up to build, because I'm not going to show you a lot of functionality because I've covered it in other tutorials. And basically what I'm trying to show you is how to deal with the actual platform io.ini. So over here, we're going to have to figure out what this is. In past tutorials, I would say search in this file. But now they've broken it up into an ini folder with particular files for the ini. So in this case, it's an LPC176X, I believe. And so in here, there's only two options to choose from. And we know that the actual turbo is an LPC1769, so we're going to copy that. Then we're going to go over to configuration for the platform io.ini and paste this over our default environment for the past one. Now, there's another thing you need to realize is that in the .pio build folder, it says Mega2560. Generally, they make a build to verify that it builds no problem before they actually upload their newest Marlin version. And in this case, it's Marlin 2.0.9.1. So in order to clear this out, what we can do is click on the garbage can over here, which will clean the folder, and that will remove any instance of the previous build. Once that's complete, in the case of this board, there's two ways to load. I'm first going to show you this method, and then I'll go back and show you the other one. But if you click the checkbox, it'll start to build for you. It's a series of compiles. Now, what you need to know about this is if it does fail on the first build, try clicking the checkbox again, because sometimes things build out of order. But if it fails after the second time, find the first instance where it's red, correct the issue that you see there, and then rebuild again. Because any error that occurs thereafter in your build may be a cascade of errors due to the first one. So now that we're complete, we have to go over to the LPC1769 folder. We then have to go down here and find the firmware.bin. So we're going to right click on the binary file and we're going to say reveal in file explorer. Now, if you go down here to the actual USB drive with our SD card, you can see there's a firmware.cur. This means a previous firmware.bin had loaded. What that means is after it loads, it renames it to all capital letters firmware.cur. That is so it doesn't keep loading every time you power up your board. And it also helps confirm that you've loaded your firmware. So I'm going to go back over here, right click on firmware.bin and send this to the USB drive. Now we can confirm it's there and we can then go over and load this on our board. So I'm going to click on the workbench for a second, take the drive out. I'm then going to place it inside of here. And I'm going to connect power that I'm running off USB for the jumper. If you do need to run direct power, you can always move the jumper over here and then run it off your power supply. But for now, I'm showing you with 5 volts of power only. So we'll load it and see what happens. So this might take a second. You may see a flashing light, but the beep is a good thing. So what we need to do now is go over to Pronterface for a moment. And inside of Pronterface, when it comes up, you'll see that there's a COM port 1. This is just opened before we actually loaded the Marlin firmware, so we don't know what the default COM port is. So one trick that I like to use is actually going to my desktop, and I'm going to type in Device Manager. And then when that comes up, you're going to go over to your COM ports, and it says that it's COM port 7. So the other one is actually default for the desktop computer that I'm working with. So I'm going to close this. I'm going to go over here and see if it's in the dropdown, which it's not. So I'm going to highlight this. I'm going to backspace over 1 and press 7. So now I'm going to connect to the board and see if it works, which it does work now. So it says connecting, printer is now online. So one of the things I do to test this on the actual board is I'll click over here and put in the G code M119 and press enter. Now, since there's no end stop connected, they're all going to say triggered, and it may vary according to your end stop, but my tutorials will cover that in the playlist. But now I'll show you the second method to load your board. Okay, now that we're over on VS Code, what I'm going to do for our actual logic change, so that you can see the other way to load, is I'm going to search on invert. And this should bring us hopefully to our end stop logic, which you can see right here. And I'm going to change the Y axis to true, because that way we'll see the change. So to load the actual firmware in this case, that's the only thing we need to change. Is down here, instead of the checkbox, we'll use the forward right arrow, and this means upload. So I'll click on that. This may take a few moments. If there's an error, obviously we'll do it again, but this will push it to our board, and I'll show you why in a moment. So the build should be somewhat quick, but it could be a little bit longer than normal. So it's completed, and then you see this little part here that says uploaded to the disk, being the D drive. If we were to go over to the actual desktop for a second, we could see what's occurring here by clicking on the D drive. And our previous build was just a few moments ago, so the new build is actually right here. So in order to load this, we'll just go over to the workbench, we'll pull out the actual connection, we'll reconnect, and then we'll go back over to the software for Pronterface, and we'll reconnect to the board because the COM port's going to be the same. So it's connecting and printer is now online. So now I'm going to do M119. To check the status again, see if it changed. So as you can see, the logic was reversed for the Y minimum. So for those of you that are interested in seeing tutorials before anybody else on YouTube, I do place them up on Patreon so my patrons can see them. And for those that tip on PayPal, I'm eternally grateful because it's a great way to offset the costs to make these tutorials. And thank you for that. So please like and subscribe and share. And thank you and have a nice day.